That's just me. Shoes off, yes? Hello? Hello?
Hello. My name is Rich.
This is Rich. What is it?
My name is Rich.
Rich! Thank you, Rich. My hearing is kind of... Well, I can't take my shoes off with both hands occupied, so I'm going to put your glass down, and I'm going to just... I'll just grab this. I don't know how sturdy that is, but...
It's not rooted.
Not really. Scare me, will you, Bob? Okay, there we go. Hello, Rich. Nice to meet you. Happy holidays.
Thanks. Nice to meet you, too.
Thanks. I'm Carter, by the way.
Carter.
Hello.
That's your first name?
That's the one name. I use. Not exact.
Carter. Carter.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, I brought you
a beautiful
mask on. I brought the yummies for you and Bob for later, or you and Bob and Rich, or whatever. They're sort of... They're re-gifted homemade cookies.
Oh, I love homemade.
So they weren't homemade in my home, but you'll see.
They were made
in someone's home.
Got it going.
And
yeah, it's
my friends, once a year does this thing.
Nice. It's been recording for I don't know 15 minutes.
You need to keep that on high
now
resolution.
That I've somewhere,
it's 4K.
I think I'll just take advantage of that fact and share the wealth.
You're not going to have audio on it, so we can talk.
And I threw in a couple of the Ferrero.
There is audio, but I figure you have to talk anyway.
Just there's a little space in there, but I said, do I want an empty space in there? And I said, no, I'm going to just put the Ferrero Rocher. So you don't have to do that tonight. You can keep that for yourself for some little tiny party you want to have with tea or something. Tea and cookies. Tea and cookies.
Do you want some coffee or tea or water or?
If you have tea, great.
Don't be too picky. Like blackish tea or?
I prefer tea that doesn't have lots of caffeine in it.
We have
Honey lavender
is just fine. I have a call when I'm with my family.
Is what now? You're on a call with your family?
No, I have the call with you when I'm with my family.
That's
great. Let's
see.
I'm on a call with my family.
I just got off a Zoom call with them.
Oh, really? And how did that go?
They just reminded me how I really don't want to
spend oodles and oodles of time with them. Generally get along, or are they generally critical, or what's their...
I don't expect you to have to stop talking for this.
Childhood.
So. I'm going to treat you like you're 12 years old.
Good.
That is just great.
Like they had to get the doors.
That's right, exactly. It's like, it's, like you say, it's quite amazing.
Did they have a key wire, maybe?
Oh, sorry.
No, not at all. I'm sure it's not going to get any hotter. Very good. I mean, I'll wait to drink it. I like when it steeps.
How many minutes do you want
to
get that for?
Oh, that's right. I have an instinct about this. It's never very good, but...
Oh, Janet, do you happen to have any chamomile tea?
No. Do you want some common? I have hobby tea, which is very common. And I have honey lemon. Honey lavender tea.
Honey lemon. I said, oh, well, I think I had the wrong flavor.
Oh.
Now we're going to check for passion tea after I see.
Or something with with ginger in it, I mean.
Oh, she has ginger. Ginger was her first choice.
Ginger tea right here.
Look at that.
Oh, great. Excellent. Yeah, I like ginger.
There you go.
Thanks.
So are there any other family relationships that... not let him just be. And he has become an adult. It's exactly like what you're saying. You can't, criticism is not in his lexicon.
And it's constructive criticism.
Doesn't matter. Yeah. Doesn't matter. He just said, but because of what I did to him, yeah. He just has so much difficulty taking any kind of criticism, yeah. Especially constructive criticism, because that means he has to do something about it. He just doesn't.
Like, he would never hire a life coach, you know.
Oh, no,
I would love to have a life coach tell me what I'm doing, you know, what I can do better.
Give me a clue.
I guess he's just not enlightened.
I know nobody here who enjoys that status. I keep reaffirming that I am not enlightened so that maybe someone will mistake me for someone who is enlightened.
Well, we could say dedicated to the enlightenment.
Dedicated to the enlightenment, yes.
Well, I'm certainly committed to it. I mean, I have the, but the truth is, I keep getting in my own way.
Yeah, that's
it. So, as soon as that happens, I'm just a small button. Aspirations. Do you have a little plate or something on which I could place this tea bag? Because I don't want it to dribble on your surfaces. We can clean it later. I just want to make sure.
This will be your dessert plate.
Aren't you wonderful? Thank you. Double use. I might even bring honey lavender back to the... I'll try not to squeeze too hard now, so I can keep some of the juice inside.
Yeah, you can get it at, I think you can get it at
Well, I only picked it because it's not, it's a very nice flavor, I'm sure, and it has no caffeine, or at least it seems to not have caffeine.
Right.
Unless it's for me, I normally go with the passion fruit.
I love passion fruit.
Well,
it
seems
really
great.
Is. And also the juice.
Does this have caffeine?
It's hard to find, no.
Okay. No, that's actually a very calming influence for just kava in general. You know, you have natives in certain countries that literally chew whatever flavor that is, that they chew the leaves. And
ginger flavor.
Oh, you have the ginger one. I'm sorry, I thought you had the kava one. Never mind. Everything I said about it is not correct.
Oh,
so
you can't
ginger
choose.
Is supposed to open up your circulation.
Oh, it sure will. You bet.
That's great.
Okay, thank you.
You know, Shannon in Kentucky, she would make smoothies and blend ginger into the smoothie.
Mm-hmm. I do that.
Along with kale and other
turmeric.
Yeah, it was really good, actually.
I'm not a big kale fan for some reason, and I think the reason is because people don't cook it enough. You know, they like to enjoy it raw, and the problem with raw is, for me, is that it tends to be bitter, and
yes,
I don't know if it's because they pick it late in the season or because they pick it long after they should, but it just...
They might pick it early in the season.
That could also be a good reason.
Well, if it were on its own, I think it would be pretty bad, but...
Yeah.
But since she mixed it with ginger, and I think she put lemon juice in it,
sure.
Too,
right.
Then it was pretty good.
Yeah, I've had kale before in smoothies, but I think what saves it is the vanilla ice cream and the caramel.
Always save smoothies.
Yeah, and the caramel, and it just, you know, it's just all of a sudden, wow, this is really amazing, and it is.
Yeah. That is really good. And I'll add one to that.
Mm-hmm.
You can put malt in there. That would probably make it.
When I was growing up, we would go, my folks owned a restaurant. But it wasn't a restaurant where you'd sit down with, you know, student time. It was like a diner. But it was a diner on the regular street. You know, you'd walk in, it's like, there's the diner. And it was like, had a funny name. It was like three D's and an L.
Like an East Coast style
drink. It was East Coast. It was New Jersey. And had a long counter, and then there was like three or four tables kind of thing. Bantas, booths.
have like chrome on the outside kind
of
thing?
Some of the strip, a strip of chrome. And, you know, with a little kind of thing, and then underneath it, and they called it a luncheonette.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if that's a term that we use out here, but back then it meant something. It was like a, right there, luncheonette, which they were not open for dinner. That was the message you got. If it's a luncheonette, it's not open for dinner.
That's what the restaurant
Yeah, when they call it a luncheonette, it usually means they're not open for dinner. And so what would happen is they'd be open for breakfast. Where my dad learned to cook breakfast, very, very good, and then lunch, and he made the best grilled cheese sandwiches in the world, as far as I know.
That's great.
And he was good at it, and he liked it, and he enjoyed it, and he could do it over and over and over again, and it was wonderful. Anyway, why am I talking about the luncheonette? Something happened in the luncheonette.
With malt.
Malt. You could order your shakes. And for like, I think it was a dime, he'd do a thing of malt, and you say, I'd like a malted milkshake, please.
Those are my favorites.
And he would just, with the nice, really, the iron cast ones with the big propellers on the bottom, and you put them in.
And then you end up with 2 cups of it, probably, with some extra.
Well, you wind up, what happens is he pours it into one of these little, like a sundae kind of glass, and you get to keep the little metal container that you can put in the extra. And malted milkshakes were great. Most people who ordered malted milkshakes ordered vanilla, but a couple would do malt, chocolate malt. You'd have a chocolate malted shake, and he'd make a shake, and then put some whipped cream on there, and, you know, put it in front of you. And 45 cents, I believe it was at the time.
Oh, what a ripoff.
I know. I'm like, but he charged an extra dime for the malt, so.
Yeah, malt is expensive.
No.
I don't know, back then it was. I don't know what they do with it now, but.
I mean, it's relatively expensive.
Yeah.
It's like, I think, it's hard to find in the grocery store because hardly anyone buys it, I guess.
What is?
Malt.
Malt has some right here.
You have malt? Yeah, well, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can do all sorts of things with malt. We only used it for the shakes, but yeah, it was like that was the deal. And after school, I'd go there every day. I mean, they didn't make a shake for me. I didn't have 45 cents. Yeah, malted milk, perfect. Throw that in the shake, and you just a couple scoops of that, and you're in business with vanilla ice cream and malted milk.
I like the chocolate.
Chocolate malt is perfect.
I would have it with almost any kind of ice cream. But,
mm-hmm.
What I'm thinking of is like some kind of berry, like blackberry.
Strawberry malt?
Yeah.
You could do that. Oh, that. Oh, absolutely. They didn't do it because we didn't know. For some strange reason, back in New Jersey, I don't think I ever ate strawberries. I mean, we just never bought them. They were like, I don't know if they were ever in the store because I didn't go with my mom when she shopped. She never took the kids when she shopped. Like, when hell freezes over, I'll take the kids into a shopping center. You know, we'd stay at home with Dad, or we'd stay at home with my oldest sister. She was like 11 years older than us.
Maybe she was afraid that you guys were going to act out in the store?
Well, she was just afraid that we were going to drive her crazy.
Oh, yeah.
And there were lots of ways that you could do that. I mean, there were lots of ways that you could go, Mom, can we have this? No.
Oh, right.
Can we have that? No. How about this? Can we have this and then that? No.
Yeah.
And then after a while, she was just like, leave me alone. And we'd go, oh, okay, time to go. And we'd all, you know, down the aisles, we'd move and split up. And there were no cell phones where you could, like, ring them up and find them.
Oh, yeah.
It's so funny.
I've seen a lot of it. Like, hey, Mom, will you buy me a toy? Will you buy me another toy? Kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Don't forget the magic word.
Why?
But it was just like, you know, we would just hold stuff up and she'd go.
Yeah.
And after a while it was like,
you're not coming to the store anymore.
Like, that's right. That was it. The only time we would go to the store is when we had to fit something. So if it was going for my shoes, I got to go, but the other kids didn't.
Yeah.
If it was shirts,
mean, she, you know, she had two old, I had two older brothers and one oldest sister, so it was never really all that big of a challenge for her to do shit, but shoes always, when we got to go, and it was like, sit.
Yeah.
Roll over, play dead. No, 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 just sit. And you sit, and the man would come along and go, here's some shoes.
Okay.
And then we put the shoes on, and they'd either fit or they wouldn't, and that was it. We had our shoes.
When I was a kid, every time my father took me to the shoe store, the people would measure my foot.
Yes, with the little thing, that, the funny
that
shaped thing.
The metal thing.
Yeah.
And now they don't do that anymore.
No, you're on your own.
Yeah, you're on your own now.
You're on your own. It's just, it's like, you know, of course, again, there are shoe stores that sell $150, $250 shoes, and they come in and they make sure that everything's okay, you walk on the carpet, and they go, how does that feel? You know, and they really care because they want to make sure. Remember, you probably don't remember, I'm sure you're not old enough for this.
Well, 48.
Oh, then you're definitely not old enough. They used to have x-ray machines in the shoe stores.
Oh, I heard about this.
And you'd step over into the x-ray machine, and they would put the plate in, because you're going to pay a lot for shoes, and they would take an x-ray of your foot, and they would look. It would come out, and they'd bring it in the back, and they'd develop it, and they'd bring it out. Well, it seems as though your son has a flat pack, blah, blah, blah. Well, you need one of these, and it's an extra $7, but we think it'll make the shoes last longer, and we'd either get them or we wouldn't. Mom would just like, oh, it's just that I take iron. And we'd be replacing shoes every 6 or 7 months. She goes, how do you run through these things? You're just going to school. I go, yeah, but they, you know, we go on the playground and we move around. And they don't just make us stand in one place.
Oh, right, yeah. You go out for recess.
Real recess. Real recess. Not recess where you just stand there and wait for something to happen because you don't want to damage your clothes. God forbid you come home with a rip in your pants. What's that? What? Oh, I fell. Joey pushed me. You let Joey push you? Well, it was either that or grow a set of eyes in the back of my head. He pushed me from behind.
Oh.
Because that's how you get your tear in your shoe. When somebody pushes you from behind, of course, you land on your knees. Oh. If they push you from behind, you know, you land on your butt. Who knows what happens then? But usually a fight. But they push you from behind, you go down and your pants rip, and now you have to deal with mom. And mom's going, so what do you expect me to do about that? You could sew. Oh, sew them? You expect me to sew them? And we have that discussion. I'm like 9 years old, for God's sake. Oh, wait, something good?
Yes, I want you to see a video that was sent to me in campuses this topic.
Which one? Fixing holes in pants? Oh, yeah.
X-raying shoes?
No. This is
about to start. Or it pushes the girl.
Oh, and she has her little, what you call it? That's right. Yeah, she pounds the shit out of him. Good. Very nice.
Well, he's got his head down. He's not going to be
hurt. They sent him up with boxing gloves for this.
Apparently.
No, I think he took a cheap shot.
While she was
boxing.
Turned around.
Yeah, she was turned around.
Yeah, we never actually.
Right up for a year.
Right. Right, absolutely. Well, but didn't he eventually die from that?
No. He didn't die from that. He died from something else.
Ah.
He spent a year, he wrote his book about pure cheap, and it was his style, and came back and fucked the guy again. Boy, in a bear fight.
Oh, I see.
The guy sucker punched him as he was walking away.
Ah.
Broke his neck.
Broke his what?
His neck.
His neck. Got it.
He died from a field for a while.
Oh.
Wow. Interesting stuff going on in the world back then.
Well, then his son got killed too, right?
I don't remember that story. I think he did. In fact, he was actually in some. I think it happened when he put a gun that was supposed to be like a gun for the movie, and there was a cap in it. And so what happened was, even though the gun didn't have a bullet, but just had a blank. When the blank went off at his head, it caused a concussion that damaged a bunch of stuff, and he didn't recover from it. Is what I understood.
Yeah, I think I remember this. He didn't know if you you shoot it with a blank, it's still a lot of pressure coming out.
Yeah, it's concussion, absolutely.
And I think if I recall, it broke a piece of his skull out.
Oh.
That went into his brain.
Mm. That's entirely possible. I don't have a lot of the details of what happened. I mean, that's how they knack cows. They call it knacking. But they actually have one of these things. It's a hammer driven by a bolt. Well, basically, you have an object, flat surface, but what's in it is one of these. And behind it is a pressure kind of thing that fires compressed air. And they basically put it on the head of the cow, and they push it, and it goes like that, and then it causes the cow to die. And that's how they kill the cow without making them bleed.
The thing, you just kill it that way.
Yeah, they do. Well, they do it on the forehead, right there between the occipital, right between the two lobes, and they just basically click it, and then it fires the hammer out, and it just basically creates a concussion and kills the cow. It takes a couple of seconds. The cow doesn't feel any pain.
It's strong enough to penetrate the skull.
Oh, I'm sure it does. Whatever it does, and that's how they kill them without having to.
I watched that.
But the bleed, yeah, absolutely. It's It's, there you go.
You worked in a slaughterhouse?
I did.
For a month, you said?
Yeah. Well, it was one of the few well-paid jobs you could get in order to
Absolutely. Absolutely. Slaughterhouse is always, you can make good money. It's not only is it unionized, but it's pretty well protected. Because people eat meat. Nobody's going to stop eating meat. I mean, they might now. Nowadays, with the I was reading an article, and they said they've closed all the slaughterhouses in Chicago, and he said based on the high contamination rates that are going on in slaughterhouses, guys must be giving themselves high fives with their tongues, because there's so much contamination.
Oh wow!
And so they just shut the slaughterhouses in Chicago, in Illinois. So
what I don't know where Montford, Colorado is relative to the rest of the state of Colorado. But
well, it's right above Denver, which is right above Colorado.
I know that they had a nuclear weapons manufacturing place not far outside of Denver, I think.
Hmm. Interesting. Yeah.
Actually, I think they had a strategic airfield.
Was SAC based in Colorado? Well, I think there's a mountain there.
Oh, it's Cheyenne Mountain.
Cheyenne, of course. And that's where they
NORAD.
That's where NORAD, absolutely. And that's and what's interesting about that is that it goes down quite a ways. You go in, and it kind of closes and it's, you can go down, and you go down like 70 or 80 feet minimum. And I'm told that it goes low enough to be able to they heat it with geothermal heat. So I don't know how far down you have to go to be able to tap into that, but it's quite an amazing facility.
It's on these huge springs.
Was it?
It's on these huge springs.
Yes.
This thick.
Yes.
And the coils are, the linings are that thick.
Sure.
So in case there's an attack.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I've seen a video of that. They've got office buildings built inside the cave.
Yes.
That are on those springs.
Yes. Yeah. What's interesting is that a lot of the technology that they use for that is now being used in Japan. What they use for their buildings, so because they have earthquakes every day. I mean, you can hardly go through a day without getting an earthquake. But their buildings are 40, 50 stories high, and you think, how in the world can they build that? And what happens is it's almost like they're on these huge rollers, and so the building can literally just move back. I mean, it doesn't move back a lot. I mean, there may be 12 inches on either side of the edge of the building, but the thing can move back and forth and to absorb most of the shock. And then, of course, there's those big, huge, gigantic spring shock absorbers, so it can move and vibrate, and they don't crash. They don't come down. And they've had those for probably 20, 25 years, so I'm sure they got them. I'm sure they got the technology from NORAD. And
that reminds me, about 20 years ago, I lived in San Francisco,
okay.
And I took the bus to downtown every day for work. And I used to, at the time, they were the Asian Art Museum,
yes,
which is like this big marble granite building.
I've seen it. Wonderful, fabulous.
Yeah, at the time they were digging underneath the foundation and putting it on some kind of springs or something mm-hmm. that would let it roll around
absolutely
when an earthquake came.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that was a huge project.
It is. It's near Civic Center, and it's still, believe it or not, the Asian Art Museum is still there. I've never actually gone inside because of the way they have it set up. They're only open certain days of the week. And
I've never been in it either.
Yeah, it's one of those monuments that you go, oh, that's interesting. On the other hand, I've been inside the Civic Center. I've been inside the dome and the mayor's office. That's right. And I've been in there like, for a while there, I was in there like three times a week because I went to the sheriff's office, and the sheriff's on the fourth floor. And you can walk around, and there's all these wonderful, lovely, you know, crown molding and dados and what lovely stuff. And the sheriff's office isn't quite that ornate, but you go in and, you know, you do your little business at the front, and there's a big, gigantic back office area, and you pay your money, and you get your stamp, and you go on your way. But, yeah, I used to love going there because that was like one of the, you know, they had weddings, always weddings, and you're walking through the lobby to the second lobby, and you see people on the big gigantic stairs that go up, and they'd be like sitting there like holding each other's hands and smiling.
Yeah, there was a wedding going on last time I went through.